Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Goethe, A Very Short Introduction, by Ritchie Robertson, read by Nigel Patterson. Preface. In 1878, the Victorian critic Matthew Arnold wrote, "Goethe is the greatest poet of modern times, not because he is one of the half-dozen human beings who, in the history of our race, have shown the most signal gift for poetry, but because, having a very considerable gift for poetry, he was at the same time, in the width, depth, and richness of his criticism of life, by far our greatest modern man." If we disregard some dated language, race, man, Arnold has stated the key reasons why Goethe demands our attention. First, Goethe was a great writer. By poetry, Arnold means not only lyric poetry, in which Goethe certainly excelled, but literary writing in general. Goethe produced masterpieces in almost every genre. Poems on the largest and smallest scale, plays and novels in varied kinds, autobiography, aphorisms, essays, literary and art criticism. Second, Goethe addressed the greatest issues of his and our time, and he did so on the basis of unusually wide experience. In private life, he experienced love, marriage, parenthood, friendship, bereavement. In public life, he helped to govern a country, admittedly a very small one, and saw at first hand the horrors of war, a battle, a chaotic retreat, and later the insolence of occupying troops. He never considered becoming a professional writer. For a long time, his ambitions were set on visual art, and throughout his life he probably devoted as much time to the study of the natural world as he did to writing. Goethe claims our attention primarily as a supreme writer, with an exceptional amount of interesting material to write about. I stress this because the image persists of Goethe as a distant and nowadays unexciting Victorian sage, and also as a serene Olympian figure above ordinary human passions. Nothing could be more false. Goethe assumed a calm pose precisely in order to control his turbulent emotional experience, and his approach to life was wholly individual. Both in action and thought, he defied convention. He scandalized contemporaries for living for many years in a loving relationship with a woman he was not married to. And on every issue, as Arnold rightly says, Goethe asks implicitly, "But is it so? Is it so for me?" However, though Goethe's essays and aphorisms are rewarding, his main works are literature, and they offer the complexity, the clash of different perspectives, the contradictions and the avoidance of easy answers that are characteristic of great literature. Goethe's works inevitably bear the stamp of the world he lived in. In his youth, we find him chafing against the petty restrictions of the old regime in Germany. In his extreme old age, we find him considering the gains and losses of modernization and imagining projects of social reform and technical progress. He was deeply marked by living through the French Revolution and the 20-plus years of war that followed it. Intellectually, he was shaped by the Enlightenment, and by its commitment to understanding the world by means of empirical and historical study, though he rejected the egalitarianism and irreligion of the Enlightenment's radical wing. In Germany, Goethe has long been an iconic figure. Criticism of him sometimes arouses fury. This has not always been the case. In his lifetime, his opposition to trends such as Romanticism and German nationalism, and the frequent difficulty of his later works, made him seem marginal. His supposedly immoral domestic life, his detachment from Christianity, his political conservatism, and his employment at a princely court provoked many attacks. "Since I began to feel, I have hated Goethe," wrote the left-wing radical Ludwig Börner in 1830. "Since I began to think, I have known why." It was the official intellectuals of the German Empire, founded in 1871, who elevated Goethe into a cult figure and artificially smoothed his image. The present book is not a hagiography, nor an attempt at debunking. It is a personal book in which, without forcing my presence on the listener, I have tried to express my own views about why Goethe matters, and why his main works remain endlessly rewarding. I do not offer him as a universal genius or an infallible sage. His achievement in science seems questionable, and his political views have only limited value for the present day. Nevertheless, he was more than just an author. His literary works are intimately connected with his autobiographical and scientific writings, his letters, and his many recorded conversations. To explore his immense oeuvre, 40 stout volumes, including commentary in the latest edition, is like exploring a world. This book is intended to help listeners into that world. In quoting Goethe's poems, I have mostly given unambitious literal prose translations, but there are a few instances where no translation can suggest the dignified movement or the extreme concision of the original, and in these cases I have reproduced Goethe's German along with a prose translation. I am very grateful to Matthew Bell, Kevin Hilliard, and Catherine Nicholas for reading the whole of this book in draft, and to Barry Nisbet and Jim Reed for reading parts of it. Their comments have been invaluable. The opinions expressed here are my own, as are any surviving mistakes. Chapter 1. Love. The Sufferings of Young Werther. Goethe is perhaps the greatest love poet of modern Europe, and much of this chapter will be concerned with his poetry. However, it was in his early novel Die Leiden des jungen Werthers, The Sufferings of Young Werther, 1774, that he wrote about love in a new way which enraptured innumerable readers. The 25-year-old Goethe, working reluctantly and rather aimlessly as a barrister in his native Frankfurt am Main, suddenly found himself famous. The novel, following a favourite 18th-century device, is presented by a fictitious editor who claims to have collected documents with which to recount Werther's life and the circumstances of his suicide. These documents are letters, all written by Werther to a male friend. They bring us so close to Werther's experience that many readers have identified wholeheartedly with him, despite warning signals. Werther comes across as passionate, warm-hearted, responding rapturously to nature. His imagination enables him to project himself into other people's emotions. He is free from snobbery, friendly to ordinary people, loves playing with children, and is repeatedly irked by the social conventions that would restrain his natural impulses. There are, however, ominous hints about his emotional volatility and his past tendency to depression. Nature is not enough. He wants love. What is the world like without love? He asks his correspondent. Like a magic lantern without a light. Letter of the 18th of July, 1771. Love is soon embodied in Charlotta, always called Lotta, a young woman in her late teens who supports her widowed father by looking after her six younger siblings. She is charming, practical, selfless, but thoroughly corporeal. She and Werther meet at a ball, where Lotta admits her fondness for waltzing, a dance then considered rather bold because it involved physical contact. Werther is soon enraptured. Their relationship is anchored in everyday events that are described simply and freshly. For example, it is a splendid summer. Often I sit in the fruit trees in Lotta's orchard, and with a long pole detach the pears and reach them down from the very tops. She stands below, I lower them to her, and she takes them. Letter of the 28th of August, 1771. But even Werther's most vivid images are ominous. The magic lantern implies illusion. The pears suggest forbidden fruit. For Lotta is engaged to Albert, a practical, unimaginative, hard-working administrator, the antithesis of Werther, who is a dilettante artist. After Albert's arrival, Werther's frustration makes him as intensely miserable as he was previously ecstatic. His love becomes a tormenting passion. Nature now seems a scene of constant destruction. Threatened with emotional paralysis, he wanders about at night, forcing his way painfully through thorn bushes in order at least to feel something. Separation from Lotta does not help. Werther takes a job as secretary to an ambassador at a small princely court, but his disregard for social convention gets him into trouble. He resigns his job and is eventually drawn back to live near Lotta, who is now married to Albert. Here, the editor intervenes with a commentary that henceforth alternates with extracts from Werther's letters. We learn that Werther's constant visits are disrupting Albert and Lotta's marriage, and that Werther himself is falling into hopeless depression and has already resolved on suicide. As a prelude, he pays two fateful visits to Lotta. When she remonstrates with him for his self-destructive behaviour, he indicates his inner violence by scowling, grinding his teeth, and accusing her of being Albert's mouthpiece. Later, seemingly calmer, he reads aloud to her from Ossian, the elegiac prose poems by James Macpherson, which 18th century Europe took for an ancient Celtic epic. The intense melancholy overwhelms them, and they meet in a passionate embrace. Lotta regains her self-control and dismisses Werther for good, despite his pleas. Returning home, he arranges his affairs and writes Lotta a long suicide note, interrupting it only to send his servant to Albert to borrow some pistols, on the pretext that he is going on a journey and therefore needs defence against highwaymen. Lotta guesses why he wants the pistols, but says nothing. Werther shoots himself at midnight and is found dying early the following morning. This was the novel that took Europe by storm and made Goethe a celebrity. "I know the book almost by heart," wrote a noblewoman soon after its publication. "The first part in particular has quite divine passages, and the second is horribly beautiful." Napoleon, who talked with Goethe for an hour in 1808, had read it seven times. The monster in Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, 1818, reads Werther and finds in it a never-ending source of speculation and astonishment, considering Werther himself a more divine being than I had ever beheld or imagined. A French translation appeared in 1776, an English one in 1779. Today, the Lotta House Museum at Wetzlar, near Frankfurt, displays not only numerous editions, literary imitations and parodies, but much Werther-inspired merchandise, including plates painted in China and showing scenes from the novel or merely suggested by it. Lotta mourning at Werther's grave was a favourite. Why this vogue? Intensely emotional novels in letters were not new. The 18th century was the age of sentiment as well as the age of reason. Two of its fictional masterpieces, Samuel Richardson's Clarissa, 1748, and Jean-Jacques Rousseau's Julie ou la Nouvelle Héloïse, 1761, both based on misguided passion, excited comparable enthusiasm. But while these consist of letters exchanged among several protagonists, in Werther all the letters are by the title character, giving the novel unprecedented concentration and intensity. Moreover, Werther's experiences are firmly grounded in a familiar German small-town setting, with many homely everyday details. Most importantly, the novel presents love as simultaneously an emotional and a physical experience. "Oh, how it courses all through my veins, when by accident my finger touches hers, or when our feet touch under the table. I pull back as though from fire, and a mysterious force draws me on again. There is a fainting in all my senses," reports Werther, letter of the 16th of July, 1771. And not long before his death, he is shocked by experiencing a highly physical erotic dream, letter of the 14th of December. Goethe went further than any previous writer in presenting his hero as a union of mind and body. In doing so, he extended the range of experience that literature could express. And since literature is not just a commentary on life, but interacts with it, he also extended the range of what people could experience in their lives. The union of physical and mental experienced in Werther corresponds to a major theme in the philosophy, psychology, and medicine of Goethe's time. The late Enlightenment was no longer satisfied with the conception of the mind and body put forward in the 17th century by Descartes. For Descartes, the two were so separate that the body could be imagined as a self-contained machine, though its connection with the mind remained inexplicable. Goethe, like the philosophical doctors of his time, uses the term Kraft, power or energy, to mediate between physical and mental experience, and to link the individual to the natural forces at work around him. Werther uses this word continually, as when he complains how narrowly the active and inquiring powers of a human being are confined. Letter of the 22nd of May, 1771. The interplay of mind and body is emphasized especially when Werther and Albert debate the morality of suicide. The conventional Albert condemns it as moral cowardice. The empathetic Werther imagines a suicidal disposition as a kind of illness, so that the suicide no more deserves blame than does an invalid who dies of fever. Such passages led the novel to be condemned as justifying or even glorifying suicide. It was claimed that the novel prompted a wave of copycat suicides, and the claim cannot be completely dismissed, for one young woman drowned herself in 1778 with a copy of Werther in her pocket. However, Goethe placed in the second edition of the novel, 1775, some verses explicitly warning readers not to follow Werther's example. Even without them, it should have been clear that Werther's suicide results from his pathology, and also that, being accompanied by a long letter addressed to Lotte, it is an act both of violence towards himself and extreme emotional cruelty towards others. The novel as a whole is a balanced contribution to the late 18th century debate on how suicide should be understood and judged, now that many people no longer accepted the religious sanctions against it. Werther as confession? To place Werther in the history of 18th century psychology is a salutary alternative to focusing on its biographical origins. However, Goethe's biography and personality are important. In the autobiography, Aus meinem Leben, Dichtung und Wahrheit, From My Life, Poetry and Truth, which he wrote largely between 1811 and 1814, he famously describes his works as fragments of a great confession. We must treat this description with all due caution. He also tells us that throughout his life he would cope with his powerful feelings by transmuting them into an image. And it is clear, both from his later autobiography and from contemporary testimony, that the young Goethe felt disturbingly intense, barely controllable emotions, which alternated between boisterous enthusiasm and restless melancholy. A poem written in uncertain English admits the 16-year-old's volatility. In moments of melancholy flies all my happiness. In the first emotional relationship that we know anything about for certain, with Kätchen Schönkopf, he tormented her with fantasies of jealousy, which she bore submissively till she finally rebelled and left him. He ruefully portrayed his own insufferable behaviour in the early play Die Laune des Verliebten, The Lover's Moods, 1767. He tells us in Poetry and Truth that he often thought about suicide. So perhaps it is not surprising that Werther should be partly inspired by an actual suicide. On the 29th of October, 1772, a young man named Karl Wilhelm Jerusalem, whom Goethe knew slightly, shot himself. The case attracted wide attention because Jerusalem's father was an eminent theologian and churchman. Goethe's friend, Johann Christian Kestner, sent him a detailed account of Jerusalem's unhappiness and death on the 2nd of November 1772. Like Werther at court, Jerusalem had been unhappy in his work and had suffered a social humiliation. He had an unrequited attachment to a married woman, whose husband forbade him to visit their house. He took long, solitary walks through the woods at night. He borrowed pistols from Kestner and committed suicide in exactly the same way as Werther does in the novel, dressed in the blue coat and yellow waistcoat that Goethe would make into Werther's trademark costume. Even the last sentence of the novel, "No priest attended," is taken from Kestner's letter. Goethe's unabashed use of the Jerusalem material, what must the young man's bereaved parents have felt, may be said to illustrate the egotism of genius. so does his treatment of the Kästners. Before her marriage to Kästner, Goethe had been warmly attached to Charlotte Buff, who has always been assumed to be the original of Werther's Lotte. The parallels are close, and Goethe even wrote an apologetic letter to the Kästners, forewarning them of their appearance in the novel. However, Werther is not a roman à clé, nor a disguised autobiography, and to identify fictional characters with real people is at best simplistic, though it provided an adequate pretext for Thomas Mann's fascinating novel, Lotte in Weimar, 1939, known in English as The Beloved Returns, in which the widowed Lotte visits Goethe, now an elderly dignitary, in Weimar in 1816. What matters is the situation that Goethe's novel depicts. Intense, unconsummated attraction to an unattainable woman. This situation would recur several times in Goethe's life, the most famous example being the intimate friendship he enjoyed with the married Charlotte von Stein in Weimar, from 1775 till his sudden departure for Italy in 1786. Even while writing Werther, he was spending so much time with the newly married Maximilienne La Roche, daughter of the novelist Sophie La Roche, that her husband, a businessman 20 years her senior, became annoyed and may well have banned Goethe from the house. In 1775, for a change, Goethe fell in love with an accessible woman, Elisabeth Lili Schönemann, daughter of a rich Frankfurt banker, but he felt that her smart social circle regarded him as an unconventional eccentric, an uncouth bear in Lily's menagerie, the image used in the poem Lily's Park, and his unannounced departure on a trip to Switzerland in May 1775 may be seen as an escape from her. Behind the women to whom Goethe was attracted, although or because they were inaccessible, we can discern his sister Cornelia, 1750 to 1777. The siblings were deeply attached. Goethe describes Cornelia as unhappy, worried about her plainness, denied any education beyond the usual middle-class female accomplishments, and kept under surveillance by their well-meaning but strict and often authoritarian father. In 1773, much against her brother's will, she married the magistrate Johann Georg Schlosser, 1739 to 1799, but led a lonely and unhappy life with him. The constellation Goethe, Cornelia, Schlosser resembles the triangle Werther, Lotte, Albert. When Cornelia died in childbed in June 1777, Goethe was devastated. He wrote to his mother 5 months later, "With my sister, such a strong root holding me to the earth has been chopped off, so that the branches above, which should also have been nourished by it, must wither away." This heart on fire. Against this background, the early love poetry is rich in emotional complexity. A recurrent theme is the poet's need for someone to calm his turbulent emotions. It seems as if Goethe needed love not to stimulate his passions, but to allay them. This is clear from a famous poem associated with Friederike Brion, a clergyman's daughter in the Alsatian village of Sesenheim, with whom Goethe had a relationship while studying in Strasbourg in 1770 to 1771. Beyond the highly fictionalized account Goethe gave 50 years later in Dichtung und Wahrheit, we know little about Friederike. It is hard to guess how deep the relationship went, or why Goethe suddenly broke it off in August 1771. But we do not need such knowledge to appreciate the combination of energy and neediness in the poem beginning Mir schlug das Herz, My Heart Beat, which Goethe wrote probably in 1771 and published first in 1775, and later in a revised and, by common consent, enfeebled form as Willkommen und Abschied, Welcome and Departure. One evening, the speaker suddenly resolves to ride off to visit his girlfriend. My heart beat, quick to horse, and away wildly like a hero to battle. This feels excessively, disturbingly impetuous. On the nocturnal ride, the ghostly, sinister landscape seems to externalize the speaker's suppressed anxiety. His passion feels self-destructive. My spirit was a devouring fire, My whole heart was melting in its glow. When he meets his beloved, her gentle joy calms him down. At their parting, she evidently walks back to her house, and he follows her with tearful looks. You went, I stood, and gazed at the ground, and gazed after you with tears in my eyes. The former hyper-masculine hero is now a vulnerable and anxious person. The need to be calmed persists after one of the great caesuras in Goethe's life, his move in November 1775 to the small court of Weimar, where, thanks to his celebrity, he was invited to be companion to the 18-year-old Duke Karl August. There he met and rapidly fell in love with Charlotte von Stein, 1742-1827, wife of the Master of the Horse. A contemporary describes Charlotte as gentle, serious, with a refined sensibility and expressive dark eyes. Her marriage was probably unfulfilling. She and her husband often lived apart. At first, she had to restrain Goethe's impetuosity, refusing for several years to let him address her by the intimate pronoun du, and exercising an authority enhanced by her noble status and her greater age. She thus ensured an attachment which lasted till Goethe's departure for Italy in 1786. Early in their relationship, in April 1776, Goethe sent her the enigmatic, deeply personal poem Warum gabst du.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.